There is a sugi in Chassidus, a discussion in Chassidus, that is called Oir Mayim Rakia, which means literally light, water, or a liquid, and Rakia. Rakia means a coagulated liquid or a coalesced fluid that achieves some kind of a firmament, some kind of a hardness. Literally, Rakia means the sky, the expanse of the sky. But contextually, it means something which is more solid, more strongly bonded even than liquid molecules are in their relationships with one another. Oir Mayim Rakia. Light, a liquid, a fluid, water. And Rakia means the fluid as it hardens, as it bonds together in a more solid state. I personally have a special liking for this discussion. And I think it's underrated. It doesn't get the attention that it deserves because of the profundity of the point that's being made. And I'm hoping to start tonight's class with a discussion on Oir Mayim Rakia and the evolution from Oir to Mayim, from Mayim to Rakia. There are three steps. Oir is the highest step, Mayim is the second step, and Rakia is the lowest step. And the idea basically is this. We believe in spirit. We believe in ruchnius. We believe in the neshama. That means that we believe that the entire physical reality, and by the same token, metaphysical realities, in as much as they have a reality, has a neshama, has a soul, has a spirit. And we also understand that the neshama is non-physical, it's metaphysical, it's spiritual, and that somehow the non-physical soul meets the physical body. For the non-physical soul to meet the physical body, they both have to approach each other. The spiritual soul has to come close enough to the body to be able to give life to the body in a way that the body can relate to, and that the soul can be revealed and manifest. And the physical body needs to be organized enough and refined enough to raise itself, so to speak, to meet the life of the soul which is being manifest within it. In plain words, what I'm saying is we don't believe that life, and even all of physiology, but certainly organic, living physical things, are simply a combination of electrons and atoms and chemical order and organic chemistry that is organized, it's ordered in such a way that there's a series of electromagnetic currents that run through this biological machine to give it order and integration and communication and so forth. We believe that this incredibly complex physical machine, this living machine, is as organized as it is as harmonious and as integrated and as one as it is because of something transcendent, which is spiritual, which is the neshama. And human beings have souls, animals have souls, plants have souls, and of course, according to that, even lifeless things, things that are called daimim, which means literally things that are silent, that speak nothing, also have some kind of a spiritual basis for their form and their order, which is the nefesh of a daimim, however we understand it. And in each case, needs to be a fusing, a coming together of the spirit and the material. Which leads to a simple assertion, a simple point. And the simple point is that more isn't always better. You imagine if $10 is a good thing, then $50 is a better thing, and $100 is better than that, then $1 million is better than that, then $1 billion is better than $1 million, and so on. It isn't always the case. Because in order for the human being to function, in order for the living thing to be functional, there needs to be moderation, needs to be balance, needs to be a closeness between the amount of capacity for life that the body has and the measure of the soul as it meets that body. And you can argue, and probably correctly, that if a body is better prepared, the body is more ordered, the body has more subtlety and more nuance, it's able to receive more life of the soul, and it probably does. It gets a higher measure of life or a higher form of life, a higher neshama, whatever particular language you want to use. But the constant is always going to remain. That when something spiritual meets something physical, they have to actually co-join, they have to come together. In order for them to come together, the life of the soul has to be close enough to the material and the detail of the body for them to converge. Now, technically speaking, here's how you would say it. The material half is made up of pieces. Many, many pieces. And all these little pieces are glued together in an orderly fashion to accommodate life. And there are, whatever, millions of pieces, billions of pieces, trillions of little pieces that all converge in this order to accommodate life. The neshama, on the other hand, is the other way around. It starts out as one, as a singular point or essence. And as it approaches the body, it has to diversify. It has to go from one to many to meet a body which is going from many to one. The body is made up of so many parts. The soul has to accommodate all of those parts. And of course, the purpose of the meeting between the soul and the body is ultimately to make the many into the one. The sign of a living thing is integration, unity, and so on. But technically, you would articulate it this way. The body is going from many towards one, and the soul is going from one towards many. And as I said, more isn't always better, because it has to match, it has to fit, it has to converge, it has to come together. So now, having given you this basic introduction, let's think about this in philosophical terms and spiritual terms. There are many layers of spirituality, obviously. The higher up the spiritual chain you go, the richer it is, the more infinite it is, and the more unified it is. The lower on the spiritual chain you speak, the more finite it is, the more diverse it is, and the more limited it is. And we always face the question, from a spiritual perspective, should I shoot for higher where there's more, or should I shoot for lower where I'm more likely to succeed? And of course the answer is, it depends on you, depends on your capability, depends on your work ethic. And we should always shoot for higher, but you have to shoot for higher in a reasonable way, in a measured way. And I'll explain to you how I mean this in limud, in learning. Now, we're talking only about ideas now. Seichel. There are higher ideas and lower ideas, deeper ideas and shallower ideas, simpler ideas and more complex ideas. And then there's also within each idea what's called the hafshata and the halbasha. An idea can be understood in a very esoteric and abstract form. And an idea can be brought down to a very manifest and precise form. When you understand something, b'derech ha'afshata, when you take an idea and you understand it by divesting it from a particular form, you're getting at the idea in a purer state. But when you get at the idea in a purer state, it's far more possible for you to misunderstand it or to understand it thoroughly. Conversely, when you take that idea and you bring it down to a level of halbasha, where you don't try to understand the idea in the abstract, but you understand the idea using a particular form or a particular example, you're more likely to understand the idea correctly, but you're also understanding less of what the idea is. And this is all relative to us. A smaller person understands less, a greater person understands more, and so forth and so on. And of course, the entire challenge is to grow in our broadening of our vessels, of our kalim, to be able to be open to receive a finer and a higher and a more exalted light, as it were, if you will. Okay. Now, within the realm of ideas, there are a lot of levels. There are ideas that deal with physical things. Ideas that deal with physical things you can understand very directly because you know what physical things are. In addition, ideas that deal with physical things you can prove very absolutely by measuring physical things, by making certain predictions and getting certain results. You can make certain determinations and so on. When you deal with spiritual ideas, non-physical ideas, obviously They're more difficult to understand because you can't see them. And they're also more difficult to understand because you can't prove them as concretely. And to give you an example, which we have talked about in the past, often, is that the age in which we live, and this is not my field, so I'm just going to speak to this a little bit, and I trust that the little bit that I'm going to say is not going to be incorrect. In the world, in the secular world, they have limited the definition of knowledge to physical things. What can you know? What can you understand? What can you prove? Or the word that they would choose is, what can you determine as a fact? Only things that you can prove directly by making experimentation, tests, and creating experiments which would predict how things should fall out, assuming that your hypothesis, your prediction, your interpretation of the physical facts is correct. When you make an experiment and it turns out correct, so you know you have what's called a workable theory. Anything which isn't physical, there is a, you know, the dirty word that the intellectuals use, they don't want you to know it's a dirty word, but the dirty word that intellectuals use is the word philosophy. When a scientist wants to insult you, he says, your idea is very intelligent, wonderful, but it's philosophy. Philosophy means unprovable, and unprovable means it's not a fact. And it's not a fact means that's a waste of time. That's the unfortunate reality. That's what's become of us as intellectuals, that if it's not physically provable, we can't prove it absolutely. And if we don't really regard intellectually as real. And of course, you understand how terrible a problem this is when you're talking about spiritual things like angels, like souls, like lakus, like godliness, and of course, above all else, legabe God himself, lahavdil. Because these are things which are non-physical, and you can't use physical rules and physical experimentation and physical prediction to determine these things. So they're all relegated into this big basket, this big heap, this big pile called philosophy, which means very nice, but not to be taken very seriously. Now, of course, we obviously disagree categorically. We disagree with the limitation on what's considered real and what's considered a fact and what's considered a proof for a variety of reasons. And most importantly, most notably, it's because we have emunah. We have emunah that Hashem gave us the Torah and revealed the truth in the Torah, Gila Seide Dvorav Adei Avodav HaNeviim. And in the Torah, we know things that are not physical, that you cannot prove physically. We even know things that are higher than logic. We know things that are higher than philosophy itself. In other words, there is reality to Ruchnius, even if you can't prove it using physical scientific methods. You can prove it using logic, using philosophy. And some ideas which we have, what we call Kabbalah, Hina Kabbalah, we know them because they were given to us, Baruch HaKadosh. Now, one of the areas of knowledge in this conversation is called Chakira, philosophy. Philosophy used to be, we'll go back 1,000 years, 2,000 years, very, very important. It was the equivalent of science today. It was considered the basis for how you determine truth. Today, nobody takes philosophy seriously. It's people learn it, people are interested in it. But is it fact? Is it provable fact? These are very, very subjective things because they're metaphysics, they're not physical things. But a long time ago, this is how people made determinations about truth. And Torah believed and continues to believe that when you cannot prove something physically, that doesn't mean you cannot prove it. You can argue and show that certain things must be a certain way, even if you can't make a physical experiment to be able to test it. But there's a key component to this reality or discussion. And that is that in an age where people did not use physical measurements and physical things to determine what's real, the integrity of the intellectual was much more important. That means if you're studying physical science it doesn't make a difference if you're a pious person or you're an evil person, because the credibility of what you say is based on the proofs that you give that anybody can test and anybody can measure. When you're talking about metaphysics, ruchnius, higoyin, philosophy, it becomes much, much more difficult to determine what's true and what's false, what's with integrity and what's without integrity. And therefore, in the realm of philosophy, the criteria for who could determine what is philosophically sound or not had much, much more to do with the integrity of the intellectual. And there was a shita that said that if you are going to be a philosopher, you need to be a parush. A parush means you need to live a pure life. You need to live a life that's not materialistic and not political and not jealous. Because a person whose personal life was corrupt, a person whose personal life was perverse, a person whose personal life was biased, couldn't possibly have clarity and objectivity when it came to his philosophical arguments and pursuits, because they would cloud his judgment. In other words, there was a greater connection between the integrity of the human being and the human being's mind when they were studying philosophy than the personal integrity of the human being and the human being's mind when he studies physical things. Because physical things are much easier to determine, relatively speaking, absolutely, than metaphysical things. So if a person wanted to be a choyker, a philosopher, a thinker, it wasn't enough that he was smart and that he studied the techniques of abstract reasoning and how you make determinations by processes of elimination and so on, however hakira works. But you have to be seeking truth. And whether one seeks truth, or as the expression is, one shoots an arrow and then draws the bullseye around it so it should appear true, is very, very important. And in order for a person to be considered a seeker of truth, he had to live an ascetic life, he had to live the life of a parush, which affected the objectivity of his ability to reason. And if a person lived a life of parishas, then you said when he comes up with a logical thought, with a philosophical thought, his personal integrity affects the integrity of his ideas. And you can trust, or you can trust more, that his ideas are going to be logic without a bias, logic without wanting a certain conclusion to come out. Because when you're talking about metaphysical things, and you're talking about spiritual things, and you're talking about ideas of logic, they're not connected to physical things, the personal integrity of the person is much, much more important. But there's an even higher level than this. What's the higher level than this? The higher level than this is when one crosses over from the level of understanding things philosophically to experiencing things spiritually. In other words, Ruach HaKodesh. Ruach HaKodesh, and on a higher level, Nevuah, it's not magic. It's not that Hashem comes to a person and gives you an idea. That's not the way it works. Ruach HaKodesh, and on a higher level, Nevuah, means you have a mind. And you have used your mind to the maximum of your capabilities. Right? And if we would talk through this progression that I've just proposed. First, you would learn simple ideas, physical ideas. And then you would ascend from physical ideas to metaphysical ideas. And of course, along with that progression, along with that journey, it would be necessary for you to be more precise, to have greater integrity in your muhus and your whole person. So there's greater integrity to your ideas. But there's a point at which the human mind stops. There's only certain capabilities of a person to understand ideas and to know truths and so forth. So of course we talk about in Torah and in Chassidus, there's a notion of inspiration from what comes from Hashem, divine inspiration. Inspiration that comes from Hashem means your mind could not get there by itself. But on the other hand, the inspiration is reaching your mind. Something which is above your mind is reaching your mind. In other words, Ruach HaKodesh is the end of Chochmah, right? If you have in the Hayyem Yeim, right? There's a Hayyem Yeim, which talks about Simchas Beis HaShayeva, Shemisham Shayavim Ruach HaKodesh. and the Rebbe that brings from the Friedrich Rebbe that says that Yerushalmi and the Karban Ha'eda, that it has to do with the Talumis Chochma. In other words, Ruach HaKodesh begins where Seichel ends. The human mind has certain limits, because the human mind needs to have some kind of form, or to use Oisius of Chassidus, it needs to have Oisius. And there's a transition, there's a point where you go from what you're able to understand philosophically to an inspiration that comes from the Eibishter, Ruach HaKodesh. And when it comes to Ruach, if it's true that personal integrity is important, when it comes to Higoye, when it comes to Derech HaSeich, when it comes to philosophy, the credibility of one's Ruach HaKodesh, in other words, whether one has an enlightenment, and this enlightenment is Emes, and this enlightenment is Kedusha, the personal integrity of that person matters even more. Which is, of course, why Chazal say that Ein HaNevuah Shoyda Ruach HaKodesh, and Nevuah do not rest unless a person has all kinds of exactness in his personality, in his control over the Yetzer Hara, and in his lack of pursuit of material wealth, and his lack of jealousy, and so on and so forth. These are all requisites, prerequisites, for Ruach HaKodesh to reach a person, and to reach a person in a proper way. And of course, the way Ruach HaKodesh works is the Eibishter gives you an inspiration, and you interpret that, you have to understand it with your mind. And you take the inspiration that the Eibishter gives you, that you understand with your mind, and you actually teach it to somebody else that is able to understand it. So in effect, what's happening here is that the Eibishter is giving you an idea of Seichel, that your Seichel cannot get by itself. You have to have it from HaKadosh Baruch Hu. But when HaKadosh Baruch Hu gives you the Ruach HaKodesh, it's not something which is separate from your mind. It raises the mind up. It lifts you up. It makes your mind bigger and strong. But it's incredibly abstract, incredibly ruchniyazdik, impossible to prove. And as I said before, which is why the integrity of the Baal Seichel, the Baal Ruach HaKodesh, is so much more important than when you're learning simple things and low things and, if you will, provable things, physical things. To give you a couple of examples, and I'm talking much longer than I would have expected in my introduction, but let's keep going. To give you a couple of examples, yeah. There's a famous story with the Rebbe Rashab and Chaim Ber, which I want to tell you very briefly, because I've told the story at length in the past. Come upon him. That the Rebbe Rashab asked a chosid pshat and a mayim in chsidus, named Rebina. And the chosid didn't answer. And the Rebbe Rashab complained to another chassid, Hayitochan, I asked Rebbe Chaim Ber a shayla and finished. So the end of the story was that the Rav of Kremenchuk went back home and he said to Rebbe Chaim Ber, Hayitochan, the Rebbe asks you a question, you don't answer. So Rebbe Chaim Ber said to Rabbi Tzachiel Rafalovich, the Kremenchuk Rav, who came with the complaint, the Rebbe probably did not tell you what it was that he wanted from me, because if he had told you what he wanted from me, you would have understood why I didn't answer him. He said, the Rebbe gefragt a shayle nimrei bina. He asked me a question in a mayim echsidus. And then he said, he doesn't need me. He'll figure it out all by himself. He'll figure it out by the Rebbe needs the help of a chosid. And the end of the story was that Rebbe Chaim Ber came to Lubavitch. And the Rebbe Rashab stood and watched him daven for a very, very long time. And then when he walked away, he said the following. Eres gerecht. Ich habe sich gekannt einkehren an ihm. Ich habe gewollt, aber wissen Sie da, mit Seichel allein kann man durchgehen. And in English this means, he's right, I didn't need his help to understand the Maamar. So why did I ask? Because I wanted to know if this is an idea that can be understood intellectually alone, or you can only understand that they have Ruach HaKodesh. In other words, a Rebbe has Ruach HaKodesh. And Ruach HaKodesh and the mind touch. And they touch in the kind of way that there is a point of abstraction of ideas which is so fine, then you're not sure if you understand it or if you feel it. And the only way you can determine that you understand it is you ask somebody that you know doesn't have Ruach HaKodesh. And if they understand it, then you know it's understood. And if they don't understand it, you're not certain whether you understand it, whether it's come into your mind or it's speaking from directly from the soul. So this is how it works. Ruach HaKodesh is an inspiration, then you have to find language and form to bring it down to the level of Seichel. The Rebbe spoke about Mashiach. The Mashiach is going to reveal Teirach Adosha v'derech Nevuah. And the Rebbe asked the question, this is the famous Sikha, which he spoke Shavuos, Tov Shin and Aleph, Teirach Adosha miti Teitzei, where the Rebbe asked the question, how could Mashiach reveal Teira b'derech Nevuah? The halacha is Teira leba shamayim hi, ve'ein novi rashi l'chadash dover mayata. You're not allowed to use Nevuah to expound on the Teira. So the Rebbe gave a very involved explanation. And the point of it, the Nekudas Abir, was that Mashiach is going to reveal the secrets of Teira, what's called Helim Sheni b'metzias, using Nevuah. But after he experiences the enlightenment, he's going to understand it and explain it to people who don't have Nevuah. And if they understand it, then it's Seichel. If they don't understand it, then it's not Teira. In other words, it doesn't become Teira because he sees it with his powers of prophecy. It becomes Teira when someone without Nevuah and that Ruach HaKodesh understands it. So now it's been brought to the level of Teira. That's Bekitzer, that's briefly what the Rebbe says. That's how Ruach HaKodesh works. You experience an enlightenment, and from the enlightenment, you bring it down to Madrega of Seichel. Now, using this platform, this mashal that I just spent quite a bit of time developing, you can understand a little bit of the phenomena of Oyer Mayim Rakia. Oyer Mayim Rakia basically means there can be a higher enlightenment and a lower enlightenment, a higher prophecy, a lower prophecy, and for that matter, a higher understanding of an idea and a lower understanding of an idea. A physical thing is easy to understand, or it's understood on a basic level. A philosophical thing is much more subtle, and it's more difficult to understand because you never understand it directly, understand it indirectly, and you have to sense it rather than understand it thoroughly and comprehensively. And of course, accordingly, the personal integrity of the Baal Seichel is so much more. And then when you add to that the dimension of Ruach HaKodesh, this is an even higher level. The point is that everything that we understand on a lower level was once part of a greater understanding on a higher level. And what we could understand on a higher level was once part of an even greater idea understood on a higher level still. There's a vort in the name of the Raga Chavar, and I believe it's in the Rebbe's Sichas, which I think is very helpful in illustrating this point. That the Raga Chavar used to say that kol ha-teira kula nekuda achas. All of Teira is one point. And he would add, for me, the Teira is Esen Nekudas, for me, the Teira is 10 points, but if I understood the Teira even more deeply than I understand it currently, I would see how it's all one. In other words, ideas are fluid. Ideas cross each other, and they go in and out of each other. The separation of ideas is based on the limitations of the intellectuals. A simpler person needs to divide ideas into areas, into disciplines, into physical components in order for a person who has lesser intelligence to understand. But if one has greater intelligence and he can understand things on levels of greater abstractions, he sees more unities, more connections. And it's not pseudo-intellectual and simplified unities and connections. It's deep and with integrity. Unions and connections, because he understands it deeply. And the more of a Baal Seichel one is, the more deep one's mind is, the greater unity he sees. So the Raga Chavar is saying, in effect, that simple people learn the Torah, see the Torah as being made up of thousands of individual ideas. When one gets smarter and learns more, and primarily learns deeper, they start to see the unity between ideas, even extremely diverse areas of Teira, the halachas of Tumentare, and the halachas of Mominis, and the halachas of Yomtif, oftentimes share philosophical, theoretical ideas that are constant, that are the same. And the deeper one goes, the greater unity they have. And the ultimate unity is that the whole Teira is one idea. And to me, the Raga Chavar says Teira is 10 ideas. And as a student of mine once asked me, "Nu, if the Raga Chavar understands the whole Teira is 10 ideas, all he has to do is tell those 10 ideas to us and we'll know the whole Teira." And of course, all of us understand how silly that is. Even if the Raga Chavar could find words to articulate those 10 ideas, we would have no capacity to understand them because they're too abstract, they're too ruchniistic. So, you know, as often happens when people learn abstract things, this is one of the biggest phenomena that you see when people decide that they're ready to learn Kabbalah. So they open up Sifrei Kabbalah and they start to read, and yeah, I understand and explain. And they don't even begin to understand what they don't understand. They don't appreciate what's written there. They don't appreciate how the words, the language, is speaking to ideas that are so high and so spiritual that they just completely miss it, and they create a distortion, which is pathetic. And that's a mashal for this idea called Eir Mayim Rakia. Everything that exists comes from Hashem, and Hashem is one. And it emerges from Hashem in a state of oneness. We call that Eir, Ein Seif. Ein Seif has, Ein Seif is translated as infinity, but in Ein Seif you don't have infinite detail. You have infinite unity. The spirit of all that is integrated into one single light. And not only the spirit of all that is, the spirit of all that can be. If there would be, you know, an infinite number of universes with an infinite number of different systems of how they would, their laws and how they would be governed, in the Ein Seif, it's all part of that greater unity. Oir. And of course, to relate to Eir Ein Seif is a virtual impossibility. Although we talk about Hishtalshalos and Gilui and how Nevuah has a connection to Eir, but it's very, very abstract. So what happens is you go from a higher level to a lower level in this discussion is that the Eir becomes Mayim. That means to say the abstract oneness of all that is, as it's included in the level of Eir, becomes more, I can't use the word material because we're dealing with Ruchnias and not Gashmias, it becomes more pronounced, more felt. And as that occurs, the one begins to become the many. And the lower it goes, the closer it comes to us, and the more, if you will, detail emerges from the unity as it's going towards the many in order to be able to relate to us and to a world and to a creation which is defined by many, defined by diversity. So an idea, for example, as it exists on the level of Oyer, is part of the infinity of all ideas. An idea on the level of Mayim is how that idea has become more manifest. And by the virtue of the fact that the ideas become more manifest, the divisions within the Eir that account for one becoming more begins to emerge. And then when you come to the level of Rakia, here it congeals, it hardens, it becomes distinct, it becomes fixed. So Eir is how all ideas exist in a maximum state of unity. In Rakia is how ideas exist in a maximum state of manifestation. And Mayim is a level in between, where it's no longer as abstract as it is in Eir, and it's not yet as concrete as it's going to be in Rakia. To use the Ruach HaKodesh as the illustration, on the level of Ruach HaKodesh, all of the Torah is part of one great light. On the level of human understanding, the Torah begins to diversify into many different distinct ideas. And technically, when they talk about Eir, Mayim, Rakia, the terms that they use are Keser, Chochma, and Bina. Eir would be Keser, Mayim would be Chochma, and Bina would be Rakia. And there's many, many other allusions, but that's one of the basic ones. And technically, what that means is, in Keser, there are no Oisias, there's only Eir. In Chochma, there's the beginning of Oisias, but the Oisias are very bottled to the Eir. And in Bina, the Oisis are very, very pronounced. So the idea is the same. But as the idea exists on the level of Kesed, it's part of the infinity of ideas, the infinity of light. And there isn't anything to affect the pronouncing of the divisions within that infinite possibility. In Chochmah, as we learn about it in Chassidus, there's the beginning of the division. Ideas become enlightenment, flashes. Individual flashes, distinct flashes, but each flash has so much possibility and so much plasticity. The expression that is used is water is nide. Water has an adhesive quality. Water molecules stick to each other, but they're fluid. They move around. So they're more concrete than the way they exist in Eir, but they're not as concrete as they're going to exist in Rakia. So Chassidus will occasionally bring this model of Eir, Mayim, Rakia to attempt to enlighten the idea of the descent of something from a higher level to a lower level. The purpose of this particular form is that they want to talk about the light itself. They don't want to talk about the body, they want to talk about the soul itself. The soul is one. And on the highest level, the soul is one in a way of Oir. Oir means to say the soul on the level of Oir does not have any distinct parts. The whole soul sees, for example, the whole soul hears, the whole soul feels, the whole soul tastes, because there's no divisions. As the soul is going to descend towards the body, it's going to have to diversify. That one part of the soul is going to sustain the eyes that see, another part of the soul is going to sustain the ears that hear, another part of the soul is going to sustain the nostrils that smell, and so on. You see, but the body is going to make real divisions. As the soul descends from a higher level to a lower level, the divisions are all theoretical still, because there's only ruchnius. But the ruchnius is coming closer to be able to be completely or truly divided up when it's going to reach the goof. And that's what's unique about this form, of this mashal, this idea of Oir Mayim Rakia. Oir is Pashut, Mayim is Pashut, and Rakia is Pashut. But the Pshitas of Oir is the furthest away from Tziyur. The Pshitas of Mayim is closer to Tziyur. And the Pshitas of Rakia is so close to Tziyur that Tziyur, so to speak, takes it over. But the Tziyur is out, just like the Tziyur is separate from the Oir. The tzir is separate from the mayim, and the tzir is separate from the rakia. This is the discussion of erim mayim rakia. And again, the point is, Chassidus is trying to get us to appreciate the concept of abstraction. Right? That's the deal. We live in a very applied world. And when Chassidus talks about metaphysics, it talks much, much more than understanding physical things. It talks about much, much more than understanding things altogether. It talks about enlightenment and oir. And Chassidus has to find language and form, as the famous expression is, "La'hafshit advarim migash miyusan," to allow us to relate to spiritual things, to abstract things, to godly things, to transcendent things in a way which is as close to the truth as is humanly possible. Because our tendency is to materialize everything. Our tendency is to give form to everything. Our tendency is to create a body for each. And in Ruchnius, there isn't body, there is neshama. And the higher you go, the less body there is, and the more neshama there is. The less division there is, the more unity there is. So one of the ways that Chassidus attempts to articulate the abstract nature of Ruchnius is by saying that everything that comes down, even in as much as it's spiritual, the lower level, the lowest level of that spirituality would be called Rakia. The second level of that spirituality would be called Mayim. And the highest level of that spirituality would be called Oir. Oir, Mayim, Rakia. An idea descends from a spiritual, from a higher, more unified spiritual place to a lower, more formed spiritual place through the steps of Eir Mayim and Rakia. Now the reason for this discussion, which is going on almost for 40 minutes, is to discuss Perek Dal of our Mayim, Basi Legani. I chose to have this conversation with us without a context, because I wanted to make it clear, and I hope I made it clear, number one, and I hope I didn't use Sfas Yester. It wasn't too verbose, which could be confusing. I know that I talked a lot, but hopefully it allowed us to relate to the idea in a correct way a little bit. How does it come up in the Maamar? Because our Maamar is talking about Amud. And we're translating the word Amud as a beam. Now someone pointed out to me that physically a beam are the horizontal beams in a ceiling, and the vertical beams that run from floor to ceiling should be called columns. But we're using the word beam because the word beam is very convenient. It allows us to incorporate two ideas into one word, one English word. The Hebrew word, of course, is amud, but the Hebrew word is beam. There is a beam or a column which holds the ceiling up, and there's a beam of light which brings the light from a higher level to a lower level. And our Maamar is teaching us that when you build the Beis HaMikdash, or the Eskafia, v'eshapcha, and you create Kroshim, you're zeche to Amudim. And the Rebbe said, Amud has two translations. Amud means a beam, means like a physical column, which sits on the ground and reaches up into the sky. And Amud means a beam of light, which ascends from a higher level to a lower level. And the Rebbe made a fascinating argument. The argument that he made was that all matters of metaphysics, all matters of ruchnius, including the ruchnius de kemochama with the Yetzer Hara, including the ruchnius de kemochama of Eskafi of Eshapcha to transform Kedusha into Klipa. And I saw in another Maamar where the Rebbe takes it even one further step further. Even the ruchnius of Kabbalah Seil itself, anything which has to do with the psychological side, the spiritual side of the person, conforms to the laws of Amud, or beam, which has to do with the beam of light. And how does the beam of light work? That the yesod, the foundation, is lamayla, and the amud is lamat. It comes from heaven to earth. On a higher level, it's more. On a lower level, it's less. There's only one exception to that rule. Only one. And the one exception to that rule is the actual physical act of doing a mitzvah. Any spirituality associated with that physical act, whether it's the kavana, or it's the iskafia, or it's the milchama, that's all part of the ruchnias. And when it comes to ruchnias, the way an amud works, it's a beam of light that's more higher and less lower. Only when it comes to the actual physical act do we use the physical analogy, of a physical column, a physical amud, which sits on the ground. And of course the argument is the physical world has a source in Atzmus Musain Sav Baruch Hu. The Yesh HaNivra is a reflection of the Yesh HaMiti, the physical Yesh, the physical creation, that in its lifelessness, in its dormancy, in its silence, is a Yesh, exists in a way they don't know its source. And that Yeshus comes from Atzmus Musa, is an expression of the Yeshus of the Eibishter himself. So our Maimir's argument is that when a Yid serves Hashem, at the Eskafi of his Hapch, he brings an incredible amount of light from heaven to earth, a beam of light from heaven to earth. But when he then does the actual physical mitzvah, he's creating a beam from earth to heaven, and this is Atzmus as opposed to Giluyim. This is more or less what Perek Beis and Gimel and then Perek Hey on the next page are discussing. In explaining this, the Rebbe goes off to discuss this discussion, what's called Emen, Aleph Mem Reish, Ein Mayim Rakia. And initially he's going to argue that Oyer, Mayim, Rakia are a succession. First Oyer, then Mayim, then Rakia. Obviously, Oyer is the most spiritual, the most abstract, the most plain, the most a reflection of its source. And Mayim, how is Mayim the night? It's beginning to congeal, it's beginning to coalesce, even though it has loose bonds, because liquid is fluid. And then, of course, then it becomes a solid, the aglidu Mayim, it congeals, it coalesces into a solid state, which is even lower than Mayim. And these three steps are describing how Ruchnius comes from a higher level to a lower level. This entire model of Eir Mayim Rakia is consistent with the spiritual concept of a beam, where the Yesod is Lamaila, the foundation is above, and then the light is below. But the Rebbe wants to argue that there's two concepts in Eir Mayim Rakia. And he brings Emer, he brings Eir Mayim Rakia into our Maamar to help understand both ideas. The first idea is obvious, that in a higher level there's greater light, Oyer, in a middle level there's a lesser light, Mayim, and the lowest level there's even less light, which is Rakia. But he also wants to argue the idea that on the very, very lowest level, there's a possibility, there's a prospect where you can have a connection to the very highest level, based on the idea that whatever falls lower must have a higher source, or what has a higher source is able to descend lower. And this is the discussion we're about to embark upon, and this is why I gave you this lengthy discussion in Maamar Rakia, because the Rebbe is now going to explain it here in the Maamar, and he can explain it in two aspects. So let's not waste any time. Perek Dalet. Now, when I begin to read, you may not immediately see what I told you. But as we journey through this page, it'll become more and more apparent. Okay, so let's begin. It says that Rebbe and Perek Dalet, however, there's an outstanding question. Mipnei ma? Why is it that b'yesh ha-nivra dafka, the physical yesh, the created yesh, a yesh which is created by Hashem in such a fashion that it is projected, it is thrown, it is catapulted, so to speak, to be separate from HaKadosh Baruch Hu in the maximum degree that it should be a yesh hanivra. It's created, and it denies any association with its source. And in the yesh hanivra, hu yesh ha-amiti, hidden within the false ego of the physical creation, which is in total denial of a source, you have the true ego, which is the independence, the self-sufficiency of Hashem himself. Why is it not true that ve'eini nimtza beruchnit, it's not true in the spiritual realms also? If down here there could be an expression of the truth of Hashem, why can't there be a similar expression in the higher worlds? The lechayra, the argument, should be the contrary. Hoye tzarech liyis, it should be that yesh ha'amiti, the truth of Hashem's ego or independence or self-sufficiency, should be beruchnis anyanim, in spiritual on a spiritual level, ubinyanim ruchnim in spiritual things, shelachein nikroyim b'shem elyonim, which is why they're called higher, supernal. Lefi shem nailim b'madrega, they're a higher level. And the argument is, it's a koshken v'kalachem, but exactly the reverse. If yesha amiti, if the truth of Hashem's independence and ego can show itself at the very end of the chain, at the lowest level, you have a world which, by its basic nature, denies a creator completely. And in this world, which by its basic nature denies a creator completely because it reflects only on its own existence and shows in no way a dependency of anything outside of itself, and as such is exposing the secret of Yeshus, the idea that there is a God whose existence is by definition dependent on nothing else, the spiritual world should show that even more. And it's not the case. The spiritual world, to use a classic terminology, is ayin. And you may recall that last year we learned the Hemshech Maimorim of the Rebbe from Tavshin Tezvov, I believe, or Tavshin Tezayin, the Maimorim, which started at Yom Tov Tzayit and went till Yetat Kislev, the five Maimorim on Yesh, Ayin, Ayin, Yesh. And in the Ruch Nizdek Kavuz, you don't have Yeshus, you have only Ayin. The Rebbe says, why? If the Ruch Nizdek Kavuz are closer to the Yesh HaMiti, they should reveal the Yesh HaMiti more. And the answer is, the Mittler Rebbe explains it, but the Rebbe immediately goes into the Mishal. Gimel, Mishal, and Be'inyan uses three different illustrations to explain or to illustrate or to give examples for the idea of Kol HaGaveya, Gaveya B'Yesir, whatever is higher and higher still, Yedid Lamat, Yedid, Mislabish, Umizgale, descends, reveals its, manifests itself, and reveals itself, but nomach, nomach yaseh, and what's lower and lower still. There's a double lashon, gavaya, gavaya, and then a yaseh, and then there's a double lashon, nomach, nomach, and then yaseh. Now before we get to the misholim that the Mittler Rebbe brings, before we get to the illustrations that the Mittler Rebbe brings, this phrase is the answer to the question, basically. Why is it that only the yesh ha-amiti, the true yesh, I'm sorry, why is it that the Yesh HaNivra, only the Yesh of creation, which is the very lowest state, because it has no spiritual awareness of itself, let alone of things outside of itself, is a vehicle for the idea of the true Yeshus of HaKadosh Baruch of Atzma Saint Seif, and the spiritual rules are not? And the answer is very simple, because since it's lower, it has a higher source. And ultimately, the lowest thing, which is Yeshus, comes from the highest source, which is the true Yesh. And things above it, because they're closer to the truth, are farther away from this manifestation. Because they're experiencing some level of light or proximity or enlightenment or awareness or understanding, it is therefore not able to have the Yeshus. So this is the answer, that because it's fallen lower, it has a higher source. But the Rebbe is going to develop it, the Mittler Rebbe, by using three examples. Now, on the face of it, these three examples of the Mittler Rebbe seem to be quite arbitrary. And I just want to share this briefly. The Mittler Rebbe has a habit of explaining things by bringing many different mishalim. There's some instances where he brings four or even five mishalim that I have seen, let's say the Shariyeda and other places. And some of them seem very curious, seem very random, seem so of no importance. And you have occasions, other occasions, besides this one, where the Rebbe will analyze why he has three mishalim, or four mishalim, and five mishalim, and show how each mishal is saying a different point. And that's what's going to happen here, but first let's read the mishalim. Mashal Aleph, Ha'alef, the first example the Mittler Rebbe brings, on a page Samach Zayin, five lines into Perek Dalet, Humi Avuka Gedalef, from a great torch. Sha'oira Godel, Umi Ira Lamirachak, his light is great. And it radiates to great distances. And accordingly, when you want the light to reach the most distant, the most remote place, the torch has to be even larger, even greater. So, if you want to send a light a distance of 10 feet, you can have a candle. You want to send a light of a distance of 100 feet, you need a greater torch. You want to send a light across the universe, you need the maximum, the most powerful stars, in the greatest concentration that can carry a light such great distances. The irony, of course, is that when the light reaches the remote place, it's going to appear very small. It may even appear smaller than a candlelight that's much closer. But in order for the light to come to a remote place, in its distant source. It has to be more prominent, it has to be stronger. The stronger it is, the lower it reaches. This is a classic illustration of Kol HaGavaya Gavaya B'Yesa Yed L'mata Mata B'Yesa. Since it's a greater light in its source, it reaches a more remote distance in its manifestation. So he explains. Imkein movement is therefore understood. Asher Bechdei She'yiyeh and Nikir. In order to see the evidence of Ma'ilas Ha'avu Ka'gedeila, just how great that torch is, Yiddish. Vu Krikna Reis Yir Ilay. How do you know how great a star is? How do you know how great a torch is? And the answer, of course, is Al Ma'ilas Haner Va'avu Ka'gedeila, compared to a candle or a smaller torch, Hu B'Mokam Arachi Dafki. You see how far it travels. And the farther it travels, and the more crisp the light in a remote place, the more it's revealed how acute, how great its source is. Shom Dafkin is God. This reveals Bechinas HaGavoya Shabahavuka, the greatness of this torch. The Hagam, Asher Ha'er Shem Yidla Merachak, notwithstanding that the light that reaches the low place, who Erkot Mirei says tiny, it's a very small light, like the light of stars that we see in the night sky, for example. Even an ordinary candle will be brighter than the twinkle of a star, which is light years away. Nevertheless, this tiny little light, the fact that it's traveled this great distance, is evidence of the advantage and the power of that torch. So the Rebbe gives a mashal to illustrate the point of what has a higher source falls lower from light. A greater light reaches and touches a greater distance. And of course the argument is, only at a distance will you fully appreciate how great the source is, because only at a distance is it a chiddush that light is still reaching you. So this mashal conforms with the basic philosophical point of Kol HaGavaya B'Yesa Yed L'mata Yesa, the higher the source, the lower it manifests. And of course the nimshal is going to be that Yesh HaNivra is manifesting the Yesh HaMiti because it's farther away, because it's from a higher source. Mashal Abay is the second example. Humichavis Malei HaMayim. If you have a barrel that's full of water, so the barrel is filled to 80% capacity, 90% capacity, the barrel is able to contain it. What happens if it becomes full and overfull? And he gives a second illustration within this class. Aichochma Malei Chochma. Or a wise person full of wisdom. Now, without getting into the conflicts and the difficulties here, he sees water and ideas in the same category, as opposed to light, which is a different category. Now, how water and ideas are close to each other, closer to each other than light, the only way to understand it is because we're dealing with mayim in contrast to oid, as you're going to see soon, and as I explained to you in my introduction. When the water in the barrel is a lot, they say it's filled to its brim. If it's full to capacity, it spills outward. Only when the water spills out of the barrel. Of course, one of the ways it's described is if the barrel develops, the barrel is so full that it can't contain it, and it creates a crack, and then water shoots out of that crack. That tells you what's inside the barrel. Says the Rebbe, only the water that goes out of the barrel do you have an idea of the concentration of water within the barrel. And the same, of course, is true when it comes to ideas. Notwithstanding, the water that spills out of the barrel is waste. It's spillage. And it's insignificant, you pay how much water is inside the barrel. At the same time, the little water that spills out, nikid, it shows the barrel's full. The same is true with ideas. Sometimes the person has so many ideas in his head that it plotzes out. The intelligence of a real intellectual is measured by neilus chochma. Neilus chochma means what falls. He doesn't even intend to communicate, it sort of comes by itself. That if a person is incredibly steeped in wisdom, ideas, so to speak, fall from him inadvertently without intent, and certainly not with a direct communication. But the fact that profound ideas can sort of fall from such a person inadvertently reveals just great how great a chacham that person is. Like you have in the Maamar of Chasana, for example, that Talmud Chacham's idle chatter tells you how great a chacham he is. Sichas Chulin is not a big deal. It's idle chatter. It's nonsensical, extraneous thoughts. But in those nonsensical, extraneous thoughts, you see how powerful the mind is. That this is the aftergrowth. This is the fallout. It reveals what's going on inside. Through this dafke nikid, it's evident that the source of these ideas is an incredibly great intellectual, which has great depth, which is why this is what spills out of him. So again, notice how he puts together the mashal of mayim and the mashal of chokhma, because it's a class, it's a category. It's a category where we're not dealing with such abstraction like light. It's a category we're dealing with more applied, like ideas and like water. And again, the principle is the same, that you know how full the barrel is. You know how great the intellectual is by what spills out of him, even though what spills out of him is remote. And of course, the nimshal is that something which has a higher source falls lower. That's why in the Yesh HaNivri, we only in the Yesh HaNivri can know the Yesh HaMiti. Then comes the third mashal, or mashal agimul, or mashpas atipa bagashmi, a seed, a zera, that is carries within it the entire code of the Father, and it's implanted in the rechem, and it joins with the tipas hanukva, and together they create new life. And this is one, it's a seed, a physical seed that's representative, that carries within it, that encapsulates within it the essence of what a person is, and it happens dafka through a physical seed. It doesn't happen through metaphysics, it doesn't happen through light, it doesn't even happen through the equivalent of water, but it happens through a seed. Now, the seed is obviously not seen as mayim, it's seen as rakia, as the third step. Shemimenehu hayalada, which produces a new life, which is mimuhuslim husach, where something of substance creates something else of substance, where the second thing of substance is not a radiation of the earlier thing of substance, but it's fundamentally separate. Children come from parents, and in so many ways they're like their parents, but they're not a continuation of their parents, they belong to themselves. Because the parents give their child what's called a hashpoa atzmis, they give them something very deep, but they give something which is very deep that has their very essence inside of it. And what's their essence? As I've explained to you in many classes in the past, their essence is their separateness from their parents. And because the essence of each person is their self-identity, when they communicate that essence to their children, they give their children a self-identity of their own, distinct and separate from their parents. And what's the vehicle to carry this essence? A physical seed, a physical drop. Because ruchnius cannot bring the essence so low. This is explained in Samach to Samach, Reishon and Zayin, and in Ranat, and in many places, that to give over the essence of what you are, it has to be communicated by something which is not at all spiritual. Because if you want to communicate everything that you are through a spiritual medium, all the spirituality in the world can't carry infinity. And spirituality means ideas, feelings, sensual experiences, all of them together cannot reveal what the essence of a person is. But a physical seed can, because a physical seed is not revealing all of the person, it's simply carrying it in a hidden way. So the Rebbe explains, Muhus Chodesh, Mash'enkin, this is impossible, Bashpo Asasechel. If one were to communicate ideas for 1,000 years, you wouldn't create another person. Shashpa ruchnis, which is a metaphysical, a spiritual communication, you can't create new life. And as the rule is, only when the student, the child, has a mind of his own before you begin to teach him, then it becomes possible for him to learn, because you don't communicate a brain to the student, you communicate ideas to the existent brain of the student. And at the tipa, you're actually creating the mind of the child. Vimkein movement, it's understood, Maila Satipa Hagashmi is Dafka. The advantage of this third analogy of a physical tipa, Asher Dafka Mimena, only from the physical tipa, Neilad Mahus Chodesh, a new substance, an independent substance, an independent self-identity is created, Mahus Acher Mahus Arishin, which is a separated Mahus, from its earlier Mahus, even though it comes from the earlier Mahus, Shuashmaz Avlad, which is what a child is. So the Mittal Rebbe wants to explain the principle, though something has a higher source, it falls lower. So the first example here is light. The brighter the light, the farther it'll travel. The second example is water and ideas. The more water you have, the more concentrated the idea is, the lower it'll reach. And the third is the idea of tipa, that when you want to give out your essence, you give it through a physical point, since it's the lowest thing, it's able to carry the highest essence. Now, these three examples are in a mayim from the middle Rebbe, and again, as you see yourself, it's really not three, it's four, because mayim and seichel are joined together. And in as much as the discussion of kol hagavaya b'yesa, yered lamata b'yesa is concerned, they're not any different. The three different examples, all of them make the same point. A greater torch travels a greater distance, a more full barrel spills over more, and the seed of a person can carry his essence. All three of the illustrations say the same basic idea, that when you have more of something, it goes to a lower level. But the Rebbe wants to add something else to this conversation. And there's something else that the Rebbe wants to add to this conversation is that even though it's true that all three examples say the same thing, a greater light travels a greater distance, a greater concentration of ideas travels a greater distance, the essence of a person is manifest in the physical seed, which travels a greater distance, all three are saying the same. But specifically, he wants to argue that the lower mushal is even a greater expansion from a higher source to a lower source than the mushal before. In other words, the mushal of Rakia, which is Tipa, as you see momentarily, is not just another case where you see that something which has a higher source descends lower, but something which has an even higher source is ascending even lower. In other words, when you talk about Eir Mayim Rakia, and you speak about Eir Mayim Rakia as separate ideas, the level of Eir is spiritual, a greater Eir travels lower. The level of Mayim is spiritual, the greater the Mayim, the lower it travels. The level of Rakia is physical, or closer to physical. And the greater Rakia, concentration of Rakia you have on high, the lower it falls. The Rebbe wants to argue another point, that because Rakia is lower, the whole realm of Rakia has a higher source, and it therefore extends to a lower source. In other words, it's not only that all three ideas are saying the same thing, but actually that the third idea is saying it better than the second idea, and the second idea is saying it better than the first idea, based on the fact that Rakia is fundamentally lower than Mayim, and Mayim is fundamentally lower than Oir, and therefore, in addition to what they have in common, the lower of the three castes has a basic source and a higher level than the higher level has because it has a lower manifestation. But let's read it inside first. Now that I gave you all three Mishalim from the middle of Rebbe's Maimon, about the principle of kol hagavaya b'yesa yered lamata yesa, has a higher source, descends lower. I want to dabble. I want to analyze. Bebir inyan gimel ha-mishalim. In explaining the three analogies, and of course the basic question which some Maimonim would ask is, what's wrong with two? Why you need three? What's wrong with one? Why do you need two? And in this case, why do you have to have these three? So the Rebbe says, Hine inyan mashe kol hagavaya gavaya b'yesa. The whole idea that because something has a higher source, it falls to a lower level, says the Rebbe, it means how godliness comes to the lowest worlds. Because the way godliness comes to the higher world, you don't say that. Since the world of Atzilus, even though it's the lowest world within the godliness map, the godliness scheme, but because it reveals godliness, you can't call it low. And because you can't call it low, you can't really argue this case of what's higher falls lower. Or to say it in other words, the idea that something that is a higher source falls lower really only begins in worlds that are truly separate from Hashem. But in worlds that are close to Hashem, what is higher is closer and what lower is further. Just like the example of the two beams that we talked about in Perek, Beis and Gimel. A beam of light, in its source, it's greater than in its distance. Alternatively, a beam, a column, a physical column, on the ground is its beginning, its source, is its full strength. So all of the worlds, till Atzilus, even though the worlds higher than Atzilus have greater light, Atzilus has a lower light, you don't apply the principle of what's higher falls lower. To the contrary, you apply the principle that the further you go, the less light you have. The idea that there's a world so low where you say that the fact that anything of godliness reaches there is a simon, is a sign of a higher source, is only in the lowest worlds. So all three mishalim that he brought here of light reaching lower and water and ideas reaching lower and a tipa reaching lower really only apply in Briya, not in Atzilus and not higher than Atzilus. Because in Atzilus and higher than Atzilus, you would say that what's higher and what's closer is more, and what's lower and what's farther is less. You wouldn't apply the logic that what fell lower has a higher source. But Briya, you do say that, because it's Yesh. The Ein Zeh Namach is not considered low. The notion of something being low, to the extent where you say that in order for godliness to reach it, has to come from a higher source. It's only beginning from the world of Briya, where there's independence from HaKadosh Baruch Hu to one degree or another. The three worlds of Briya Yetzirah Asiyah. So he says, in the higher world, still Atzilus, you wouldn't apply the principle of Kol HaGaveya B'Yesa Yerd L'mata Yesa. And accordingly, until Atzilus, including Atzilus, you would not apply the principle that in Eish, Mayer, Mayim, Rakia has a mile over Mayim and a mile over Eir. As I told you in my lengthy introduction, the way Eir, Mayim, Rakia work is Eir is more abstract, Mayim is more applied, and Rakia is completely applied. So Eir is higher, Mayim is in the middle, Rakia is in the end. Until Atzilus, the constant is that Oid is more than Mayim, Mayim is more than Rakia, that's the end of the conversation. The Rebbe wants to argue the beginning with Briya. Just like in general, beginning with Briya, can you begin to make the statement that something has fallen so low must have a higher source? You can more precisely make the statement that when you're talking about how Oid, Mayim, Rakia reaches the lower worlds, Rakia reaches lower because it has a higher source than Mayim. And Mayim reaches lower because it has a higher source than Oid. And the Rebbe makes a reference to the Maamar of Tishrei of Tav Shin Yudas. And I'll be honest, I learned through quickly the Maamar Teret Tziv and the Maamar Tzur Tu'uda. And it's really near the end of the Maamar Tzur Tu'uda where the relevant idea to us is discussed. In the Maamar, the Rebbe discussed about Er Maamar Kiyah on a lot of levels. But towards the end of the second of these Maamarim, the Rebbe adds, when he's talking about Er Maamar Kiyah, that the Kiyah is the lowest and has the highest source, based on the principle that our Pedik is based on, called Agaveya B'Yesir. Which only begins in Elam Abriya. Vihine. Say that I'm Shachab Elam is Biyahu, the way things come into the lower worlds, just like things come into the higher worlds. In the Seder of Eir Mayim Rakia, the same is true that in the lower worlds it comes in the order of Eir Mayim Rakia. Be'efen the Eir Mayim Rakia. First you have light, which is a complete abstraction. Then you have water, which is a fluid form. In other words, it's not as abstract as light, but it's not as hardened and fixed as Rakia. And then comes Rakia. Commission is Bar Baruch Ab Ma'amorim Dechedesh Tishrei, such as I discussed Ma'amorim of Tishrei from Tav Shin Yutes. This year it's 60 years ago. You see, but the Rebbe is saying two things. Till Atzilus you have Er Mayim Rakia, and then much lower than Atzilus, you have Eir Mayim Rakia. But there's a basic difference between how you understand Eir Mayim Rakia in Tel Atzilus and how you understand Eir Mayim Rakia in Briya. And the difference is that in Tel Atzilus you understand Eir Mayim Rakia in such a form that Eir is always higher than Mayim, Mayim is always higher than Rakia, and you never reverse that. Because of the mashal of a beam of light. The beam of light's foundation is on the top, and the further away goes from its source, the less light you have. Beginning with Briya, you have the question of how does Briya exist altogether? It shouldn't be. Because it's a creation. And because beginning with Briya, you have the question of how Briya exists altogether, it shouldn't be. Because it's a creation, you have to say, Kvayachal, the Ebisha digs deeper for it to emerge. And the Rebbe says, in Briya also, you have the sequence of Eir Mayim Rakia. In the lowest worlds, where the principle of a higher thing falling lower is true, you still have the sequence of Eir Mayim Rakia. In other words, in Briya also, and in Asiya also, Eir is higher than Mayim, and Mayim is higher than Rakia, at least on the superficial level. It's only on the deeper level that it's turned upside down. Let's continue to read. This is Pshat in the middle of Rebbe. You know why he brings three examples? Hamashal Da'avuka, the example of a torch, because it's Eir. And of course, it doesn't mean physical light, he means metaphysical light. And as I explained to you at length, the concept of metaphysical light means a realm where everything is unified into a oneness, which is even more plain than a fluidity. It's just light. And then you have the mashal achavis of a barrel, which is also the mashal of seichel, which is like mayim. And then you have mashal tipa, which is rakia. In this case, tipa is compared to a solid, not a liquid, a solid, called rakia. Because shenaseh geshem umhus chadash, it's something that comes from the essence of a person's mind, becomes a physical thing. For lachain, which is why, this is the Rebbe is being pushed, ashtikl raya of nigla, to this transference from air to mayim to rakia, maya da glidu, when water congeals, water hardens, which means basically when it becomes ice or snow, butlo mitera shu'uvim, it stops having the disqualification of being water which was collected, because it stops being a liquid, and it becomes considered a solid. According to some opinions, if you would then take this ice, which was once pasul, because it was mayim shu'uvim, and put it in a mikveh, and let it melt, it wouldn't become, you wouldn't say that the psul of shu'uvim would come back, it's a brand new metzias, because the old water is gone, and the new water came from the ice, which was in between the water and the water, and it makes it into a new metzias. This is not our conversation, but one of the ways they prepare a mikveh of rainwater in cities, that they go to places where there's ice, which comes, of course, from rain, and they would put it in buckets, like milk crates, to have holes, so there wouldn't be a keli to make a puzzle. They'd take a freezer truck, and they would spill it into the boir of make shamim and let it melt. And you wouldn't worry about shu'uvim at all, because it was frozen when you took it. And this is the nimshal of rakia. It stops being a liquid and becomes a solid. So the Rebbe now continues. Vine. I just want to repeat one more time. We're explaining emer throughout Seyder Ishtashos. All over Seyder Ishtashos you have this sequence, oyer mayim rakia. But until a certain point of Ishtashos, we say the sequence of emer, but we always say oyer is higher than mayim is higher than rakia. At the very end of Ishtashos, you start talking about this phenomenon called chiddush, real newness. And you ask, how does it exist? And then you argue that if it were to come so low as to have a higher source. So here we start to add to our understanding of Oyer Mayim Rakia another dimension. And the other dimension is that on the surface, Oyer is higher than Mayim, and Mayim is higher than the Rakia. But under the surface, in its source, Rakia has the highest source. And this is what the Rebbe is now going to explain. And I believe that the Rebbe holds that this is what the Mittel Rebbe is trying to allude to. That even though you can say kol agavaya b'yesa yered lamata yesa using oyer, or using mayim, you dafka bring all three mishalom of er mayim rakia, because the lower idea is a higher kol agavaya and a lower yered lamata. V'hine, I'm four lines from the bottom of page samach zayin. The Rebbe says I explained 60 years ago tovshin yutes. In the Maamar of Tishrei, asher inyin bechinas emer, the idea of eish mayim ruach. Oyer mayim rakia ein irak bebias. Not only in biakim gam batzil so bekeser lamala yesir ad beeducate the mitzvah. In every level, there's the principles of eir mayim rakia. Vim can move it, and accordingly, it's understood. Asher gam sham in every place you shayech kolah gimel mesholim. You can say all three examples of avuka chavis v'tip, that the light which is higher falls lower, the water which is more falls lower, the tipa which is an inyan atzmi falls even lower. Ubechol mokem umokem, in each place, ubechol darge darge, in each step, hine gili agaveya agaveya yeser hu b'hanomach nomach v'yeser. If it is a higher source, it's revealed even lower. Lahayna this means, asher b'hanomach v'yeser b'ha'elam ha'hu, that within each individual world, in the lower level of that world, Mizgale Hagaveya Beyesa Shabel, you reveal the highest aspect of that world. But you see, in the meantime, when you say that as a higher source is falling lower, the higher source is Oyer. And therefore falling lower would be from Oyer than from Mayim and then from Rakia. As opposed to in Biyah. Because in Biyah, you don't only say that what has a higher source falls lower in a particular world. But you say that amongst the three of Oyer, Mayim, Rakia, because Rakia has fallen the lowest, it has the highest source in Atzmus. V'hine. Biklolu Seyder Ishtalshlus. The Seyder Ishtalshlus as a whole. Hari Anomach Namach B'yeseru B'Biyah. The lowest world is B'yetzir Nasiyah, V'adela Masiyah, the world of Asiyah. And as the Rebbe said before, it's not like Atzilus, where Atzilus, because it's considered a lakus, ein zeh namuch, says the Rebbe, he nesham in the lowest worlds, and specifically in our world, mizgala hagaveh, where b'yaseh is revealed the highest source. Shalemayla mehagaveh, agaveh b'yaseh, which is higher than the highest height which could possibly be revealed, shebe'erech ha'atzilus, in the world of Atzilus. Olamayla me'atzilus v'kedem ha'tzimtzum, shvatz musim husa. Hine, hu mizgale ba'tachten tachten b'yaseh. This is revealed in the very lowest worlds. Meaning to say again, that it's true that what's higher in every world falls lower even within that world, but it conforms to the law of Mayim Rakia. Eir is higher than Mayim, so it falls lower. Mayim is higher than Rakia, so it falls lower. Here we're saying something different, that because these are the lowest worlds, Rakia itself has the highest Chedesh. And the Rebbe says, the Kefal HaLoshen Tachten Tachten, twice the lowest. Moira La Yeseh Tachten She'efshiri shows of the lowest it could possibly be. She'in Tachten L'mata Mimene, nothing can be lower than this. V'hu Inyan Elam HaAsiyah. This is the concept of the world of Asiyah. To be sure, before we continue reading, I just want to say a couple of things. Number one, I'm repeating again that I looked up the Maimorim of Teret Siva and Tzur Tu'uda. And in the Maamar Tzur Tu'uda, near the end, the Rebbe says what I'm telling you, that the principle of Kol Agaveh Agaveh B'Yeser, Yered L'mata Mata B'Yeser, has two ideas, right? That oir, a higher oir extends lower, a lower oir doesn't extend as low, a higher mayim extends lower, a lower mayim does not extend as low, and the same is true of Rakia, but there's a second point. And the second point is that because Rakia is the lowest, the entire scheme of Kol Agavaya B'Yeser, Yered L'mata B'Yeser, is truer in Rakia than it is in mayim and it is in oir. He says both of those things, and that's how I'm teaching this to you. I believe that this is the pshat, but I'm not 100% sure. So I just wanted to clarify that this is my source of how I'm teaching it to you. And I suppose this is what I want to say. You see, the Rebbe gives a mashal from Oir, for Kol HaGavoyah B'Yeseh, Yered L'mata Yeseh. He gives a mashal from Mayim, of Kol HaGavoyah B'Yeseh, Yered L'mata Yeseh. And he gives a mashal for Rakia, for Kol HaGavoyah B'Yeseh, Yered L'mata Yeseh. But the mashalim are not the same. I'll tell you why. Because in the mashal of Kol HaGavoyah B'Yeseh, Yered L'mata Yeseh of Oir, how does it work? A greater light comes to a lower level, right? But when it comes to a lower level, the light is tiny. The light reaches a very, very low level, but it reaches a very, very low level in a diminished state, and the lower it is, the less it is. And the same is true with Mayim. But in Tipa, it's not that way. In Tipa, it's called Agaveya, Agaveya, B'Yeser, Yad L'mata, Mata, B'Yeser. And in the Mata, Mata, B'Yeser, you have more than you can have any place else. The physical seed carries the life of an entire living creature and creates a brand new life. The mashal of zera, of a seed, of a tipa, is a physical analogy for kol agaveh agaveh b'yeser, yered lamata b'yeser, with an additional nuance, or additional emphasis, that in the lamata mata you have more than in the maila maila. And this you don't have in Eden Mayim. This you don't have in the higher worlds. And I think this is what the Rebbe is trying to add by bringing this whole perek dalet here. Right? What was the question? The question is, if we have two concepts of a pole that the higher it is, the richer it is, and the lower it is, the less it is. And then we have another kind of pole, which is dafka lamata, atzmus, because it comes from atzmus and hus. Why shouldn't we say that just as you have atzmus down here, you have atzmus in the spiritual worlds? And the answer is, by introducing us to the idea of kol hagavoyah b'yeser, yered lamata b'yeser, everything is a higher source, foils lower, as it's articulated in Emer, Eish, Mayim, and Ruach. I'm sorry, I keep making that mistake. In Oir, Mayim, Rakia. So first of all, you have Oir, Mayim, Rakia in the higher worlds, Oir, Mayim, Rakia in the lower worlds, and it's different. And second of all, in Oir and Mayim, when something comes from a higher level to a lower level, it's diminished. In Rakia, which the mashal is tipa, when it comes from the higher level to the lower level, it remains exactly the same. And this is the ultimate idea of Kol HaGavoyah B'Yeser, Yered L'mata B'Yeser. And this is the answer to the question which our Maamar began. It's not only that because Gashmias is Yeshus and it's so low, it's Mushish, and the Yeshus of Atzmus and Hus, but that in this low level, the Yeshus of Atzmus and Hus comes without any change whatsoever. That's how low, low is. In other words, a different Echus of Nomuch, Nomuch, B'Yesir. So as a different quality of Gavaya, Gavaya, B'Yesir. It isn't only that something higher is necessary to reach something lower, but that it reaches something lower exactly as it is in the high, because that's how low it is, and therefore how deep it reaches. And it's only in Gashmias, it's not in Ruchnias. And I believe this is what the Rebbe is trying to add to our understanding by introducing us to the idea of Oyer Mayim Rakia and Kol HaGaveya B'Yeseh, Kol HaGaveya Gaveya B'Yeseh, Yered L'mata Mata B'Yeseh, two times, because he wants to argue that it's not only that it's also in Gashmias, but that it's exclusively in Gashmias. And again, I'm repeating, I taught you the Maamar here, based on the Maamar Tzor Te'uda, and I hope I'm not misleading you. If I am, I'm just misleading you a little bit. The basic Higoyin is true, but maybe some of the details, the way I'm teaching it, is not what's written in Abu Rebbe means, but this is how I understood it, based on the help of that other Maamar. And now let's finish. Page Samaches, six lines in Vezehu Inyan. This is the notion, Shahamudim Nitzavim Baruz Nafka. We have two types of poles. One kind of pole, which I'm doing by Kroshim, is a Ruchni, is like a beam of light. That the higher it is, the greater it is, and the lower it is, the less it is. And even here we could say that if it's a stronger light in the source, it'll extend lower in its manifestation, but it'll become less and less. And then we also have the beam, which is from earth to heaven, it's Dafka on earth, to the exclusion of all the higher worlds. The Kishatorich Livnes Habais Chema Godl. One must build a large baischoima, a house with a wall around it. Vo'in yigedulas havaya, which is, of course, an allusion to the greatness of HaKadosh Baruch Hu. He's taking, it's a play on the word godel, baischoima godel. Godel is gedulas havaya, the greatness of HaKadosh Baruch Hu. And of course, it says in Gemara, it's brought in Tanya B'makam, Shata Meitz, Imasam, Gedulas HaShamata Meitz, Anavis, that when you find the greatness of HaKadosh Baruch Hu, you're seeing his humility. In other words, our ability to see his greatness is because he's reaching so low for us to be able to observe. But of course, the argument is when we observe the greatness of HaKadosh Baruch Hu because we're so low, we're actually seeing less of his greatness. But we're only seeing the greatness which is observable to us. So, Take, Hashem is so great that his greatness reaches us also. But then there's another idea. Hashem is so great that his greatness reaches us only. And that's the inyan of Tipa. That's the inyan of the second mushal of Amud. Hine, b'chol say dirish talshus throughout, say dirish talshus af shesh b'chinis emir b'chol amadregis there's oir mayim rakia, higher light and a lower light and a lower light in each step. And within that scheme, oir is more, mayim is less, rakia is even less. But each one has the capacity to reach very low if their source is very high. To reveal the highest of the high, which means the Eibishter of himself, Shehu Ha'atzmus. And not only is it revealed also in Gashmias, in other words, Hashem's truth is so great that it reveals itself a little bit here, it reveals itself only here. And it reveals itself only here, and it reveals itself completely, like the Mashal of Tipa. It's revealed in the very lowest level, Shu'elam Asiyah, which is the world of Asiyah. U'basiyah Gufa, in the world of action itself, lay basiyah ruchni, is not in the spiritual Asiyah, ki in basiyah agashmi, it's the material Asiyah. U'mizeh muvan, which allows us to understand, shigam basiyah agashmi is Gufa, in the physical Asiyah itself, so ragam kein hatachtein tachtein b'yeser, you need the very, very lowest things. V'hainu, this means, asher is galos ha'atzmus, that on this earth, the revelation of the Eibishter himself, Eina ba'aveda haruchnis, our spiritual struggles, and our spiritual sacrifice, and even our Kabbalah sale, is not a seat for Atzmus Hus. Kiyim basiyah gashmi zafka, physical action. V'zeo gam kamash melag b'l'kutatere b'drushay tzitzis, which is why it says in l'kutatere in Pashas Shlach, when he uses the Moshla of Amudim Shun Tzav Mubar, it's the same example. For the pole to hold up everything which is above it, the earth has to be hard. The earth itself, which is even lower than the pole, has to be hard, as opposed to being porous and soft. The same is true of mitzvahs. Sichem liyaz ba'ofer kosha dafke in hard earth, which means physical actions. Ukumeshim esayim shama, that's written in Lekut HaTeir in Shlach, Basi ala Eila, that the action has the highest source, and it comes to the lowest levels, who are mitzvahs in eslapshu, begashmi es dafke, the physical behavior performance of mitzvahs. So here's the additional insight that this perek adds, that in the spiritual, in the physical world, all the ruchnis within the gashmis, the mesidus nefesh, and this kafi, and this hapcha, and the kabbalah seil, it's all ruchnis. And even though you say kol agaveh b'yesi, l'mata mata b'yesi, but the lower it comes, the less it is. And then you have dasi itself, and the derech mashal, the tipa. That's only here that you have the revelation of atzmos. And like I'm saying, and I hope I'm right, the atzmos which you have here is complete. It's not a touch of atzmos which can reach, quote, even gashmias, but it's atzmos itself, which is only in gashmias, based on the principle of kol agavaya gavaya b'yesha twice. You had lamata mata b'yesha twice. Now, I will admit that we could still explain it more, but I've given you a very long class and enough information for you to explore it further. And shkiyes mi yovin. And im shagisi Hashem atev yechaper ba'adi. And im itz Hashem, the next time we'll continue to learn Perek Zayin.